Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments. Alamance County is pleased to present the Alamance County Commissioners Meeting.
And doing the business of Alamance County and citizens, we ask you to watch over us, be with the words of our mouth, the meditations of our heart, and our deeds, dear Lord. We ask you to keep us all safe and sound. Be with those who have recently lost loved ones and family members and friends in Virginia Beach and others. We ask, dear Lord, that you, we ask all these things, dear Lord, in the powerful and holy name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Okay, as we get started this morning, if everybody would please remember to silence your phone and also check, you know, it's 9 o'clock. At 11 o'clock, the city of Graham may come around and start giving people little reminders of their parking policy.
Yeah.
So if you parked in a city of Graham parking spot, then you might, after a bit, run down and move your car so you don't get a ticket. The next item on the agenda is the opportunity for public speakers who are talking about things that are on the agenda. And I'm not going to go over the public speaker policy today. It's posted online. Behave yourself. Don't be ugly. And don't, embarrass yourself or anybody else. Kind of sums it up. The first person on the list is Frank Bell. Mr. Bell, were you going to speak about something on the agenda, or did you want to hold it until after the meeting? Okay. So I will make a note of that. He's going to speak at the end of the meeting. And just to remind the public that we have two public comment periods. One is for items that are on the agenda, and the second public comment period is at the end of the meeting, and that's for items that are not on the agenda. And Mr. Bell wants to be heard at the end. Then the next public speaker we have signed up is Ron Spinhoven.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I have, this is a map of, when I speak about the wells and snow camp.
Thank you.
Thanks, sir.
Thanks, sir. You're welcome. My name is Ron Spinhoven, 2709 Quakenbush Road in Snow Camp. Regarding the Hydo moratorium and issues resulting from the intent to obstruct permit issued to C. Wayne McDonald, manager of Snow Camp Property Investments. And I know you folks are hearing a lot from people from Snow Camp, but I feel that we're speaking for the whole county. I wish we could find a way to reach out to them, but I believe we speak for them as well in this regard. As we continue its review, we find more things wrong with this current ordinance. At the May 6th commissioners meeting, the county attorney stated that the mine, under the permit as he understood it, has purchased 2,500 feet, and they have that much distance between them and the nearest house, and the ordinance only requires 2,000. So he presumed they have exceeded that by 500 feet. Mr. Albright is mistaken, as the anonymous company did not even purchase full 2,000 feet needed to meet the space requirements under the old Hydo. About 20% of their 2,000 foot perimeter spacing requirement is made up of other people's property. We can tell you that other people are not happy about this unauthorized use of their property. This is apparently okay under the Hydo, under the current Hydo. At the January 22nd Board of Commissioners meeting, we heard concerns expressed by a community member regarding her fears of losing access to her well water as a result of 500,000 gallons of water being pumped daily from the proposed mining site. Despite the fact that the entire community of Snow Camp, along with others in Alamance County, rely solely on groundwater and private wells, there's nothing in the current hydro to protect our fundamental rights to clean groundwater. This is another major oversight. At least the state is looking out for us and is requiring the mining company to conduct a survey of 80 neighboring wells that they believe are at risk by the proposed mining operation. This would be on the sheet that I gave you. But my question is, why would Alamance County issue a permit to a company allowing them unlimited access to our groundwater without any review by the planning board or input from the impacted citizens? Is this really keeping with the county's mission statement to provide its citizens with high quality public services, the tools for successful economic development, and a responsive, transparent government that supports the community as the preferred place to live, work, and play? I don't think so. At the October 15th commissioners meeting, Mr.
Should
I finish? Or?
No. Okay. Thank you. Appreciate that very much. All right, do we have any commissioner responses? If not, we'll move on to the agenda. If I could have a motion to approve the agenda.
So moved.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the agenda. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Thank you. Next, we have items on the consent agenda. If no one has any concerns about the consent agenda, you'd have a motion to approve.
Make a motion to approve.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the consent agenda. Is there any discussion? If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. Okay, now we're going to have a public hearing about the heavy industrial development ordinance moratorium extension. So this public hearing, for background or information, currently Alamance County has a moratorium on accepting applications for permits under the heavy industrial development ordinance. While the county has been considering how to revise the ordinance to address many, many concerns which have been raised by the citizens. So this public hearing is specifically about whether the moratorium should be extended and how long it should be extended for, if it is extended. This is not an opportunity for people to comment about the content or the substance of the ordinance itself. The comments should be limited to the moratorium, its length, and whether it should be extended. And it expires tomorrow. So with that in mind, if I could have a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to open the public hearing. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, so speakers for the regular public comment period, you get 3 minutes. For a public hearing, though, you get 5 minutes. And I will ask around the room, and is there anybody in the overflow room today? So this is all the people who are attending the meeting. So everybody here who wants the opportunity to speak about the moratorium extension will have the opportunity. But first, I'll start with this side of the room. Is there anybody over here who would like to be heard, such as Donna Poe? Maybe she would. Come on up.
Hello.
Good morning.
Good morning. How are y'all doing?
Good, okay. Thank you.
All right, make sure it's on five. Okay. All right, so I'm Donna Poe, 1907 Quakenbush Road, Snow Camp. And I am here to request and support a 6-month or greater hydro moratorium to allow sufficient time to completely rewrite the hydro ordinance, as well as to review procedures followed in enforcing said ordinance. We are all too familiar with the problems with the 2011 hydro. In particular, the fact that a high-impact industrial permit could be approved without anyone reviewing it other than the director of the planning department, a non-elected position. any industry that impacts the community to the degree of a blast mining operation, excuse me, certainly deserves input and scrutiny from the community who are at risk for such operations. But in addition to how the ordinance is written, we also need to closely examine the process under which it is reviewed. Regarding the intent to construct permit awarded to applicant C. Wayne McDonald of Snow Camp Property Investments, the file obtained from the planning department revealed a very loose and incomplete process. Shortly after hearing about the rubber stamp permit this past October, our group had submitted an FOI request for the county application and permit documents. In reviewing the file contents, we discovered several documents were missing. For example, page 3 of the review comments by the planning director was missing. The screening plan provided by Mr. McDonald appeared to be incomplete. An untitled 2-page document dated 1/11/18 was missing page 1. The permit application was missing page 3 with attachments, and the intent to construct permit was missing page 2. Even the final site plan approved by Libby Hodges was not provided at the time. And I can assure you that we did not shuffle the papers from the planning department file, and we have reviewed each page very carefully. The initial site plan we did receive, dated 11/29/17, submitted by Mr. McDonald with the Hydro application, shows blast mining in an area which proposes a roadway over a hazardous liquid pipeline, an easement owned by Colonial Pipeline, and a high voltage power transition easement owned by Duke Energy. There is no mention of this dangerous encroachment of these utility easements or any communication with the utility companies in the review comments or elsewhere in the file. This site plan submitted by Mr. McDonald also showed 2 land parcels listed as part of the proposed property, which are part of a homeowners association with recorded restrictive covenants that state commercial activities are expressly prohibited. And what's most disturbing is that a Class 4 Hydro permit for blast mining was issued to a foreign limited liability company only recently organized in Wyoming 2017, with no documented prior experience in mining. You have heard myself and others speak of these concerns many times over the past 8 months since we all learned about this quarry together. And it's worth repeating often to be reminded of the severity of this situation and why the Hydro needs to be completely rewritten. This incomplete intent to construct permit file indicates a poorly documented process for approving a highly critical application. The county attorney previously indicated in his response letter to our inquiry of the missing documents requested that he is not responsible for making sure that all documents are included in the planning department file. If he is not, then who, if anyone, is responsible? These matters are far too serious to be treated so carelessly. We are appreciative of your expressed concerns over and over for these matters and in allowing a moratorium on any further Hydro permits until the ordinance can be completely rewritten. This is clearly a daunting task. It has to take quite a bit of time already just to identify the problems, or it has taken quite a bit of time. We need sufficient time to correct and rewrite the ordinance and to access all possible resources to help us, which could include accessing the expertise of the Institute of Government in Chapel Hill. Thank you for your time. And I just want to make mention, if I can invite Mr. Ron Spinhoven, when you get to this side, he didn't realize that we had 5 minutes, and his comment obviously is about this moratorium extension, so I'm going to invite him to finish his comment that he so eloquently wrote. So, thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, anybody else on this side of the room? Mr. Poe.
Good morning.
Good morning.
As you all know, I'm Bill Poe, and I'm here this morning as a Snow Camp resident and a planning board member representing Newland Township Snow Camp area to speak about the planning board recommendation of the Hydro moratorium extension. At the time of the first moratorium of the 120 days, the assumption was made that we had adequate time to revise the existing Hydro to a more comprehensive and restrictive ordinance, yet fair enough to allow smart growth within the unincorporated areas of Alamance County. The planning board devised a small group to review and address the concerns of the ordinance that everyone agreed that existing Hydro is a bad ordinance. Early on, the planning board small group got together and thought a lot of the issues stemmed from a public notice or waiving of spacing limitations. However, as the planning board became aware of other language within the Hydo ordinance, other major concerns came to light and started to raise the awareness to confirm that the existing Hydo is not only flawed, but doesn't take into account of property rights of the property owners adjoining high-impact industries. Besides the awareness of the language inconsistencies and the land spacing concerns and setback requirements, the planning board hasn't been able to get a quorum for a planning board meeting vote on any of the planning board business that would have included the Hydo revisions or the meetings in April and May. Planning board chair Rodney Cheek called for a special called meeting for May 23rd to discuss the future of the Hydo as the moratorium deadline was quickly approaching. As Commissioner Chair Gailey can attest, much discussion was had on the shortcomings of the attempted Hydo revisions and addressing how we could conclude with a new Hydo that could balance the citizens' rights and well-being along with smart growth while all the while preserving Alamance County's rich history and heritage of taking pride in protecting the agricultural life we so enjoy in Alamance County. The Planning Board has put forth a recommendation for a 180-day extension for the existing 120-day Hydo moratorium with the goal of writing our own Alamance County high-impact heavy industrial development ordinance that could protect our county from uncontrolled, undesirable impacts that have even more unintended consequences, that allows for heavy industry to be an integral part of our county's growth in the future. I strongly urge that the Alamance County, the Board of County Commissioners approve this request for the 180 days extension so that the Alamance County Planning Board can proceed forward with the work necessary to complete this rewrite of this extremely bad ordinance so we can get back on track with proper and productive ordinance for heavy industry. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you,
Mr. Poe. Okay, anybody else on this side of the room who wants to be heard on the moratorium extension? Okay, if not, and I'll come back and you'll get asked again. Anybody on this side, Mr. Spenhoven, if you would like to be heard on this, you can come up. And I'll mention while he's coming forward that, and this was asked of us in the last week, people who want to be heard, you know, there's three different comment times that the public can come forward. Well, three different times on this particular agenda. We have the public comment period at the beginning of the meeting where you can speak on an agenda-related item. Then we have the opportunity to be heard on the public hearing. And actually, I had said that I thought that you could come back again and speak on something that's not on the agenda at the end of the meeting, but I would have to check our rules on that and just confirm that that's accurate. But thank you for letting me say that. And go ahead when you're ready.
And thank you for letting me come back up. I'll pick up where I left off. At the October 15th commissioners meeting, Mr. Sutton pointed out the representative of the anonymous mining company Alamance Aggregates is Chad Threet, who is also named as plant manager for convicted felons with Boggs Asphalt Paving Company out of Monroe. There are two other individuals of interest connected to Boggs Paving. The person who signs checks for the anonymous mining company Alamance Aggregates is Amy Williams, who is an accountant for Boggs Paving. Also, Boggs survey manager Neil Preslar appears on surveys for the anonymous property owner Snow Camp Property Investments. I question, who are we opening our county up to by issuing Hydo permits to anonymous companies and not requiring the owners and parent companies make themselves known? On a more personal note, my wife and I purchased the adjacent property to ours with a plan of creating an innovative alternative retirement community. When we discussed our plans with the planner's office last August, there was no mention of the permit or quarry less than 1 mile from the property. This potentially kills our plans. We should have been advised of these quarry plans. There are so many deficiencies within this ordinance, it is clearly going to take more time to get it corrected. The reason for extending this Hydo moratorium to 180 days is to allow sufficient time and resources to rewrite a more balanced ordinance that does take into account not only opportunities for companies to capitalize on our natural resources, but also protects our citizens who are physically, economically, and emotionally impacted by such decisions. This ordinance must be corrected if Alamance County is truly to become the preferred place to live, work, and play. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. All right, anybody else on this side of the room who wants to be heard about the moratorium extension? No? All right, anybody over here change their mind? The chance to think
last
about
chance,
it. It's just boiling up. Got to be heard. No?
I'll make looks a motion like to close the hearing then. You can't get them out of the seat.
Okay, we have a motion to close the public hearing. Is there a second?
Second.
All right, all in favor of closing the public hearing on the moratorium extension, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Okay, so now we move forward to discussing extending the moratorium. So, Mr. Albright, the moratorium expires.
Point of order.
Tomorrow.
Do we not have a chance to comment on what took place in the public hearing?
Of course we do. And I just wanted to, before we move forward with the discussion, get a clarification about how long we can extend it for, because there's a requirement for 59 days or less or 60 days or more.
I'm talking about us responding.
Yes, I just wanted, before we respond, I wanted to be sure that we knew that we, what are we allowed to do? So Mr. Albright, is there a limitation on how long we can extend the moratorium for?
Well, the notice requirements, and I believe it's a 2-week notice published. If it's less than 2 weeks notice published of this public hearing, you can only extend it for less than 60 days. I believe there was more than 2 weeks notice. I haven't looked and seen it. It was. So you can extend it beyond 61 days.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure that we were all understood that we're not limited to 59 days or less.
But I want to be clear that under 153A340H1, if you extend it, you have to have a statement of the problems necessitating the extension that match the time of the extension.
Okay.
So we just need to be clear that that is in the record.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. So with that being said, yes, Mr. Sutton.
Well, now, well, let me ask you a question. All right, we're going to do this. Are we going to have a section where we come back and talk about the approval process of the whole deal with the asphalt? I mean,
I'm not sure, it wasn't clear, I admit.
A lot of things aren't clear anymore. You know, talking about the asphalt plant, you know, from the very beginning this thing smelled, forgive the pun on the smell of asphalt, but it smelled of asphalt. And we had been approached in the past about an asphalt plant down in the southern part of the county. Gravel's one of the biggest components of the asphalt process. And then you find out that this company is highly integrated with people whose livelihood is off of that enterprise. Now, since we've had has the asphalt company applied the other application we have? Have we not had a asphalt plant inquiry? It's just been an inquiry.
Right, we haven't been able to take any applications.
Okay, do we know who's involved in that?
No, it was a realtor that made that inquiry.
In my card playing days, I'd bet money they're related. okay, with that said, I appreciate you bringing that back up, because I hope we have a whole lot more time that we can comment about the whole process of this approval out of Raleigh versus what we're doing here. Can I just go ahead and say it?
Sure.
This isn't the way it's supposed to work, in my opinion. Government, we shouldn't have the feeling of being helpless. We shouldn't have a feeling of frustration. I mean, we're sitting here clearly knowing this whole thing was butchered, in my opinion, from every level. And you got a group down in Raleigh that's going to either approve it or disapprove it, right?
Their portion of it, yes, the mining commission.
All right, so we're sitting here with clearly an opinion And I don't think it's a matter of an election. You know, you have elections that change. Well, you know, one board voted for this. One board after an election voted for this. This isn't that. It's a discovery that could have been any board that could have discovered such a butchered process. And I don't know why we can't get that across to Raleigh rather than us sit here and do our impotent activities.
With our hands tied.
With our feelings of our hands being tied. They're down in Raleigh, and we're just sitting here, and next thing you know, somebody's going to get a letter in the mail that is, they can go ahead and put off the first piece of dynamite. I can't stand this type of operation.
Is there not some way for, in an ordinance, for us to require some transparency, some depth to the detail of who owns what? In other words, if there are interlocking relationships between an asphalt company and a mining company and so forth, is there not some way for us to require that kind of disclosure?
We can put it in the ordinance. Sure.
That's what I'm asking, right?
Yeah. Yeah, we can put it in the ordinance.
The board can write whatever they want to write in the ordinance. I'll look at it and let you know what the risks are.
Risk?
There's a risk, and it's in the statute. If you approve a moratorium that's lengthy, there is a business owner out there somewhere that can say that's too long, and I want a Superior Court judge to look at it. There's always that, and that's
right,
in the statute.
Right.
But with the development you have going on in this county, not only in this county, but in Chatham County, you've got an enormous residential development that's been approved and is heading this way. That development's going to need concrete, it's going to need asphalt, it's going to need gravel. These are the type of things that you can expect. But getting to Mr. Sutton's question, your question, you can put in the ordinance whatever you feel needs to be in there. And you changed this ordinance in 2011 to create the high impact development ordinance. What we had before was an adulteration of an ordinance from one of the mountain counties.
But that wouldn't have prevented this either.
No, it was probably worse than this.
Yeah.
But you can look at it as a board and decide what you want in that order.
I've got a question. He brings up a great point with wells. I guess my question is this, I've been in the building business a long time, and we were drilling a well on one property here, and the guy goes down, the neighbor's coming out running, "You took my water."
Right.
All this water's running underground. And where will the county be able to stand if these wells are contaminated? Are we in the position to run water out there for these folks?
Well, you've asked that question before about the 500,000 gallons a day. I asked that mining company's attorney that question. And his response was, that is surface water that comes from thunderstorms, because it's a large amount of land down there. And if they dig a big hole, it's going to collect a lot of water. And that is the amount of water they'd pump out after a major rain event. If you have 2 or 3 inches of rain right over that quarry, that water's got to go somewhere. And
well,
that's what
case
he's
in point
about.
To what I was just talking the, about, this the, well.
Right.
Lawrence Industry on Trollingwood Road contaminated the wells on this Haywood Street.
Yes, I'm familiar
with
that.
And they had to run water.
Yes.
So I'm just asking.
That was a dry cleaning company, I believe.
No, they made vacuum hose, but
okay.
Lawrence Industries, and it was surface water that contaminated those wells.
Well, environmental health and the state folks that are concerned with groundwater quality, they have jurisdiction over that. That is their area of expertise. But you could certainly put that in your ordinance.
Yeah, I think something needs to be in there on the environmental side. People's water. I mean, that's very important.
Every one of these wells within a half a mile.
Yeah, yeah.
You keep talking about changing the ordinance, amending the ordinance. How does that affect what's going on in Raleigh right now?
Well, as a county, you are given certain powers and authorities, and then the state retains their power and authority.
I understand.
And that is one of the powers that they have retained, mining and permitting mines. Because we just simply don't have the folks here that are the engineers and the experts in those fields to handle that kind of stuff. That's why they have that. They have retained that as part of the state's jurisdiction.
When's the last time Raleigh has heard about our concerns from us in a documented exchange.
Well, we had a, you know, we had that meeting at Silva. I think that may be the last time.
Sylvan.
The Sylvan Elementary School meeting. And then I'm sure there's folks that have been contacting him. I have not been in contact with the Mining Commission. I've been waiting for a response from the Mining Commission, but I have not been in contact.
I believe I'd call them first.
I'll be glad to contact
them. Well, whatever. I mean, I think this is the most out in space type process I've ever seen this county do. I'm not a lawyer, but I believe if it was me, I'd get on the horn as a representative of this county in a legal responsibility management arena and say, look, I don't know about y'all, but I don't think we want this, period. At least if we want things to come into this county, we want it to meet the scrutiny of every possible comb of the hair, and it didn't take place here. It just didn't, and we can prove that. And it's not a matter of this board's politics at all. At all. Please.
Agree.
Tim, I can't but agree with you there. I mean, I think we really do need to contact, if it's appropriate, contact the Mining Commission and the... And talk to them about this issue. I mean, it's just,
you know, it's like shrimpers up in the cabin. I was talking to a guy down at Calabash the other day about his boat. I said, "What happened to your boat?" He said, "It sank out at the jetties years ago." It was a boat called Hank, and I know all those people down there. And I said, "Well, what happened?" He said, "Well, it just started taking on water." And you know, I didn't really go into it with him, but it's like they're sitting up in the cabin. They know the boat's sinking, but nobody's going down there to repair it, or nobody's going down there to plug the hole. I mean, it's just like they're all talking about it. I mean, I'm tired of talking. I want to do something. Please. And I don't mean to be dramatic here. I'm just...
Yeah, I agree with Tim.
I've had too much coffee, but...
There's no such thing as too much coffee.
It is. When your eyes start twitching, you got a problem. So are we going to do something?
Well, I'll make a motion that we extend the
second that
period for 180 days.
Well, sure. What about contacting the mining committee?
I'd also like for us to make sure that we have some input, and I know having Amy on that committee will help a lot. There are things that we need to, maybe we ought to review it periodically as it's coming forward before it's finalized. So.
Well, there hasn't been much to review because they haven't had a quorum for 2 months in the planning board. So it's hard to get work done when you don't get a quorum at a board.
Madam Chair, can we put that in the record that this is why you're extending it? Because you had an Easter meeting, the quorum wasn't met, then you had another meeting, was it 23rd of May?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we definitely
had a quorum for that one, but nothing was...
The regular, that was a special called meeting. The May 23rd was a special called meeting for the regular planning board meetings for April and May. There was not a quorum.
Right.
And so, therefore, although a draft had been prepared by the subcommittee that the planning board had formed, and the subcommittee met regularly and worked very hard to work to address the concerns and had a draft to present. But they weren't able to present that to the planning board. And also, although a quorum wasn't had so the planning board couldn't vote, there was public comment and some discussion among those present who, taking a look over the work of the subcommittee, they raised additional questions that have not been fully addressed.
So, and also, for the record, the planning board has not voted on that approved or changes to the ordinance to bring it to the commission.
That is correct. The planning board has not had any substantive vote on substantive changes of the ordinance. The only thing they voted on was to recommend to this board that the moratorium be extended for an additional 180 days.
And that's a reasonable In the opinion of the board, that's reasonably necessary.
In the opinion
sounds,
of the,
sounds like it.
Yeah. Because of the complexity of the issue and the challenges presented by it, it appears that 180 days is reasonable.
Okay, that meets the statutory requirement. Thank you.
Okay. Steve's got a motion, and I'll second his motion for 180 days.
Okay. Before we vote, I don't want to walk out of here with somebody telling me later it wasn't clear what we were supposed to do, what we wanted y'all to do, or whatever. Do y'all think we should be able to get in touch with the mining committee and
say we want to talk? Absolutely.
Yes. I got another question there about the very issue, Tim. Would it be appropriate for us to have a resolution of this board requesting that the mining committee?
I think that's a good idea.
Sure.
I think that's the application.
What would the resolution request?
Would it be appropriate for us to have a resolution from the commissioners to the mining commission to requesting that they reject the application?
Well, you can pass if that's your resolution. You can certainly send it to them.
Let's do it.
I think we need some time to craft that.
We've got one motion in play before we go to another one, but that's.
But in that resolution, you just say, in my opinion. Due to this, due to that, due to this, we feel like blah, and then put in there what we feel like
our concerns
has happened.
Yes.
Yeah, and
I don't know if that'll carry any weight with them or not.
It won't hurt.
It won't hurt anything.
I don't think it'll hurt anything.
Can we do this before the next meeting and vote on it then as a resolution?
I think
because
that's
it needs to be.
We need to get moving. We're gonna have a resolution. Directed toward the mining board for the state, we should get on that because, for all we know, they might have the decision sitting on their desk.
Yeah.
Well.
And just haven't.
For the June 17th meeting.
That would be great. We have a motion and a second to extend the moratorium by 180 days. Before I call for the vote on that, I appreciate very much that the chair of the planning board is here, Rodney Cheek, and we have Bill Poe is on the planning board, and I'm looking around, and those are the two. I'm not seeing if there's somebody else here who serves on the planning board. If you would raise your hand, I don't see anybody else. There might be somebody in the, I saw some people being directed back to the overflow room. There might be somebody over there. So I just wanted to say to you all, thank you for your service on the planning board and Mr. Cheek for your leadership on that board. The county really appreciates that. I've heard a lot of questions and concerns about the water quality, which I share Mr. Boswell's concerns. And since we have, I just would really like to flesh out, if we could take a minute, is there anything that the county can do to require in the ordinance to work to safeguard the quality and quantity of well water in the county? Is it through the heavy industrial ordinance? Is there a way that we can phrase that, or to your knowledge? I think that Ben Pierce, the assistant county attorney, is working on this issue separately, but I think to me, this is the real nugget there.
We certainly can look at that type of language.
Well, we have a Department of Environmental Health that tells me where I can put my wells and not do this and that and
right.
the other. And I would think we have some jurisdiction through the state and the Environmental Health to oversee a process that may affect your well water down the road.
One of my concerns is that apparently in applying for their mining permit, I'm given to understand that an applicant has to get some kind of certification from the Department of Environmental Quality from the state, that there is some kind of review from the state. But as a county commissioner, I've never seen that. That's never been, I haven't looked for it, but it's not been in my official capacity brought to me. And I'm wondering if, as part of our permitting process, we can require that being made available to the county as well, so that our citizens have some kind of layer of knowledge that's what's more important than clean air and clean water.
Amen to that.
So there's that concern. I think it's, to me, very, very significant. And I'm not sure that, Mr. Carter raised the question about requiring disclosure of the entity in the ordinance. And I know that I've been part of informal discussions about that issue. How would that look if you were going to draft that into the ordinance, that we want to know who you are? You know, we want to be sure that you are not some shyster who has a long record of failed projects behind you. How do we do that? Because corporations can set up in different states at different times and evade that. I mean, how do we have draft that into our ordinance that has real teeth in it?
Well, if you have the corporate names involved, you can do searches.
Yeah, but people can set up corporations.
I know.
You know, I can go home and set up a corporation.
That's why they went to Wyoming on this deal.
Exactly. But so how do you draft that to have it be meaningful?
Well, I don't know that it's possible that you pierce that veil in some situations. I know there are corporations that are set up to make donations to other corporations, to limited liability corporations and limited partnerships. A lot of contributions come to universities through those type corporations because people don't want to know that they're giving so much money to Duke instead of Chapel Hill.
Yeah.
But, you know, I'm familiar with those, and there may be a way to do it.
But in an LLC, the members will be in there that you can look them up
right
in whatever state they're incorporated in also.
It will require a listing of the board,
right,
and a certain level of management of the corporation.
Well, depending on how they're set up, I mean, all that's public record through the Secretary of State's office. Doesn't matter what state you're in, unless you're an offshore corporation.
Right.
And then I don't know how we get to those. But we'll take a look at it.
Can we require in the application process that they check off a box if any of their officers or, you know, lists of people, does anybody here been convicted of a felony? I mean, can we ask about that?
Well,
and if so, what kind?
We ask them all.
We do that when somebody applies for a job with the county. So.
Yeah, that's what I was just thinking. Right. And also for our volunteer boards.
I was thinking the same.
Things like that. So.
Steve, being an old banker, you know what we used to call people that would apply for a loan for somebody else? Straw deals.
Straw man.
Mm-hmm. Straw deals. Yeah. Straw man. Well, straw deals.
Mm. Great. Okay. All right, well, I ask this question since we have planning board members here to try to help illuminate discussion or thoughts to take back to the planning board about what kind of things the commissioners are concerned about in particular. So definitely water quality, definitely the disclosure of the identity of the applicant. And is there anything else that I missed? I don't want to talk over anybody or cut off anybody's
you got
ability
it.
To make remarks or anything
and
like
we'll
that.
We'll discuss it more when we do a resolution, I'm sure.
Right.
As far as that.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second to extend the moratorium on the heavy industrial development ordinance by 180 days. If there's no further discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? All right, thank you. Next item on our agenda is, and it's 9:43, so we're good for time.
Do we need a motion for a resolution?
We have to have the resolution drafted.
Yeah, they'll draft and then we'll vote on it.
I'll draft it and send it to you.
And we'll have that on our agenda for the next meeting. Okay, so the next item on the agenda is an update. Let me look at our, yeah. An update on our land use plan by Ms. Cattle, our planning director.
Good morning, board.
Good morning.
Come to you with the land development plan update. We talked several months ago with you all about moving forward with the RFQ to get some qualifications in here to see who might would help us do this update. So we did send that out. We have some responses. Those responses, we narrowed down to two companies that we're going to be doing interviews on Friday. There's a small subcommittee of directors for the county, and we did reach out to one person that's interested in sitting on that committee as well. So about five of us, a good odd number to do a vote on picking somebody, and hopefully that will go well on Friday. At that point, we'll come back to you all once we can figure out some monetary value to what work they're going to provide for us and ask for the support for the monies to fund that project to get it started.
Sounds good.
Got your work cut out.
That's for sure. Thank you all.
Thank you.
If I could just ask a question. Was there a due by date on the RFQ? Was there a time?
It was middle of April. I forget the exact date. Yeah.
So you had the responses back by mid-April? Mm-hmm. And so now it's 6 weeks later?
Right. So we formed the committee to make these decisions. We gave the companies 2 weeks notice to get come to us.
Y'all interviewed each individual company?
Well, we had three responses. I've pulled two that seemed best qualified.
Okay, so you needed time to get your committee together and then schedule the interviews with the...
Right, and review the RFQs.
And review, okay. All right, thank you. Does anybody else have any more questions about that? Okay, next item on our agenda is Jeremy Akins wants to be reappointed.
Are you sure?
As our tax administrator. We're so... excited to hear that.
I wasn't sure the first time. What am I getting myself into? But I'm very
sure.
Yeah,
you know, huh?
Absolutely.
And he's done a great job while he's doing it.
Yes, he has.
Thank you. Appreciate that. But yes, the statutes call for appointments to 2 or 4 year terms. This would actually be my third, and last time was 4 years. If you're well pleased with me, I would ask for another 4 year appointment. But certainly have enjoyed serving this board the last 6.5 years.
I think Mr. Bell could probably speak to his credentials there. They've worked a lot together.
Absolutely.
And,
I'll make the motion. We appoint Jeremy for 4 more years.
I'll second it.
Okay. We have a motion and a second to reappoint Mr. Akins. If there's no more discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Okay, so next item on our agenda is an opportunity to discuss our budget for fiscal year 2019-2020. I'd ask that this be put on our agenda because there were some issues raised at the public hearing on the budget, and we're scheduled to vote on it at our next meeting on the 17th, and so I had thought this was an opportunity for us to flesh out any questions with staff so that at the night we vote on it, we're not kind of asking staff to make recommendations or how we would shift the budget, and this, you know, maybe without a full discussion of the overall implications of what we want to do. So I thought we had this opportunity, so at least we would schedule that. Before we get into a whole lot about that, I think Mr. Haygood has some information for the board about the school resource officers.
Thank you, Chair. Commissioners, the manager's recommended budget that you've received included $567,492 for 8 school resource officers. The revenue sources for those officers included $315,000 from the school system and $252,492 from the general fund. Since the time the budget has been presented to you by myself, the Sheriff's Department has negotiated a new agreement with the school system and with Clover Garden School, where they also provide a school resource officer. The revenues from the school system would now be $450,000, and the Clover Garden contract was also increased by 25% to $42,790. So the total revenue from these outside contracts comes to $492,790. The Sheriff's Department has indicated they would like to use this new revenue to add 2 new SRO officers and a new lieutenant to their SRO grouping. This would mean the manager's recommended budget that's been presented to you would need to be amended to approve these 3 positions, 2 new SRO deputies, 1 new SRO lieutenant. If the board wants to do this and agrees with this, we would budget the expected salaries for the officers and the lieutenant, and we would budget the additional revenue from the new contract with ABSS, as well as the funds from Clover Garden for the provision of the SRO there. But it still leaves a gap of $36,500 between the new revenue and what it would cost to add these 2 new positions. I've discussed this with the sheriff, and he's indicated that he could make those funds up with the money that's already been budgeted for him in the proposed budget. Basically, the way you would do that is there will be differences in between people's salaries when they're moved to SRO and when they're hired new. So the sheriff feels confident that he could cover the $36,500 difference. So these positions are not in the recommended budget. Again, this came to light after it was already presented to you. So I think you would be wise to consider adding new SRO officers. I believe there will be one officer would be split between Sylvan Elementary School and the Everett Jordan Elementary School, as well as AO Elementary School and Pleasant Grove Elementary School, and the lieutenant would be over all the SROs and would rotate around when folks are on vacation or had some kind of training to attend. So I'm sure the sheriff's happy to answer any questions. This works financially, would not require adding any new dollars from the county's perspective to the sheriff's budget, only budgeting the new money from ABSS and Clover Garden. So.
Well, what would be the impact on the ABSS budget?
So I believe we have Mr. Teeter here today, and I think they have discussed how to provide these funds and have already voted, I believe, on this contract. So.
Yeah, so we've received our planning allotment from the state, and we're getting additional support for school resource officers that we're able to direct to this, and that got us into a position to negotiate with the sheriff in order to, one, pay a higher rate for the officers to close that gap in what they cost and what we've been paying, as well as to bring on the two additional SROs, and the school board voted unanimously to provide that additional funding.
Excellent. Okay. Well, I have definitely wanted SROs in all the elementary schools too, so that sounds great.
This is something that we had talked about. I guess it could have been handled as a budget amendment after we passed the budget, but I thought maybe we should talk about it today so that sheriff can hire people. Right, and maybe because if we wait until after the budget, then it's July, then the sheriff needs to be able to hire these officers and make. Hopefully, this way they can start when school starts back.
Well, not only that, but the training is almost immediate for SROs, and there won't be any till after school starts if we don't get them in the upcoming training sessions.
So that's an important reason to include it, maybe as an amendment to the manager's recommended. So that's that. So I open it up for the commissioners. Do y'all have anything in particular you want to talk about, a concern to raise about the manager's recommended budget, an addition or a deletion?
I would like to ask you on page 4148, explain to me what we're adding to the employees fund and the sheriff's fund. This is a
48.
I think it's page 148, as I remember.
Yeah,
I was looking through it over the weekend.
I'm afraid I may not understand. So was it for the employee's salary?
Yeah.
So we've proposed this year to continue our 2% merit increases for county employees. That would also be for the Sheriff's Department employees. So we started in 18-19, employees could qualify for up to 2% raise for their performance. So those funds are again in this year's budget. And I believe I can tell you what that cost is. That does include the
it's 462,541. Is
that what yes, I believe that's correct. Let me confirm that.
When I was looking through that particular section, I could not remember what we had decided at the time, and that's why I'm asking.
So my recommendation is to continue the merit plan for county employees, and Commissioner Boss was correct, the estimated cost to implement the 2% merit program for county employees, which does include the Sheriff's Department, is $462,541. And then for the employees' health insurance, I'm recommending an additional $584,304 be applied toward the health insurance fund. This increases the premium for each county employee, which is for all county employees, from the current rate of $702 per employee per month to $752 per employee per month. Again, that's a strategy to help, hopefully help us come out of our deficit in that fund and just to meet the increased cost of the program. We're seeing anywhere from 7 to 15% cost increases for medical procedures and for drugs. So.
Okay. Thank you.
On page 10, we were looking at the unassigned fund balance. Our target is, am I correct in this, is our target then is to hit the 14% at the end of 2020?
That's correct. Well, so the audit that we just received for fiscal year 17-18 had us at $20.8 million in unassigned fund balance, which is 14% of expenditures for 17-18. So I think our goal currently is 20%. That's right. Our target to try to hit overall. We would like to hit a 20% number. So we're below that with the 17-18 audit, and then we are projecting for fiscal year 18-19, this current year, our projections are that at the end of 18-19, we will be right at $13 million in unassigned fund balance, which gets us down to about 8.5% of expenditures, which is less. But you must recall, we've approved $4.2 million to give ABSS and ACC upfront monies to begin their bond projects, which we will receive back. And I believe we also had, that $13 million includes $1.1 million that we're currently in the hole for our employee health insurance fund. So it's not necessarily going to come out of unassigned fund balance, but we feel like it needs to be accounted for somewhere. So we're showing it in unassigned fund balance. So I believe what you would see added back to the $13 million is about $5 to $6 million once we get our funding back from ABSS and ACC and we pay off our deficit in the health insurance.
Have we looked at a timeline on how long it would take us to hit that 20% target?
So I believe we'll be back to close to $18 million next fiscal year, which gets us back up close to the 14%. But it's difficult to say when we would hit 20% because we generally don't budget to build fund balance. We, you know, as you can see in our documents, I think on page 10, that fund balance document, we've been really tight with putting money in fund balance. It's been less than $1 million, which with $150 million general fund budget, that's very, very tight. That's covering the money we budget from fund balance plus a little bit back. So it's really difficult for me to say when we would grow it. You know, we're doing a really good job of tracking it and trying to make sure the board's aware of what we budgeted to spend. But it'd be tough for me to say when we might get back up to 20%.
From a bonding perspective and credit grade, having a gap between the percentage and the actual, or in our goal of 20%, does that have any effect on our bond rate?
So when we go to be credit rated for our bond debt, if the board approves the bonds, the rating agencies will be looking at our entire fund balance. They'll be looking at what we have restricted and committed to. So this 14% from 17-18 and what we're thinking will be down to 8.5% at the end of 18-19 does not include all the funds that we have restricted. So the board has money that has been put aside for other uses. For example, $2.9 million for the animal shelter for Burlington. The rating agencies look at it in the entire picture. They don't look at just unassigned fund balance. So I don't remember off the top of my head, and Susan, you might be able to help me, what our overall percentage is, including all of our committed, all of our restricted fund balances. But I think we're pretty healthy in that respect. It's just the unassigned. The money that we have, we can do whatever we want to with. It is getting lower, but we're committing it to causes. So I think we're in pretty good shape from a rating perspective because they will look at our entire savings account, not just on a sign.
Okay.
And we'll look up that overall percentage for you.
Other questions or concerns? As the commissioner representative on the Department of Social Services Board, some concerns were raised there at that board about a fraud investigator, which it was not included in the manager's recommended budget. So I understand that we have one fraud investigator who I would like to call on Adrian Day, our DSS director, because I might say something in error that
she's a lady.
She had to correct, right? So why didn't she just say it to start with instead of
good morning.
Put her bat first instead of cleanup.
Okay. So our fraud investigator is ranked 16th in the state as far as collections. But of those 16 counties, 14 of them have 2+ investigators, and we have 1.
Wow.
And our investigations have increased since January because our fraud went into NCFAS. So lots of errors, lots of ways to be able to catch fraud. The problem is we just have 1. And so she continues to get referrals, and some of them she's able to work, and some of them she's not able to work as intensely as they need. I think from the county manager's perspective, he wasn't aware that, or it wasn't really clear that this position could be 100% funded. This position receives 50% reimbursement, but we also receive between 30 to 45% incentive money. So this year, we're slated to receive, the state says, $199,000. We budgeted $108,000, because right now that's where we're trending for this year. So with that incentive money, it offsets what the county would, you know, pay as far as this position. And it actually brings additional revenue because it's more than what it covers in this position.
So what? How much does the person make with benefits?
So
what's the cost of the position, the upfront cost?
The upfront cost with benefits, we calculate it as $54,052.70.
$54,052.70. Okay, and then we get reimbursed by half of that from the federal government?
That's right.
Is that right? So it's 50% reimbursable upfront, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so then for the county's half of that $54,000, so roughly what, $27.50,
mm-hmm.
something like that, it would be your expectation that the position, through its collections of investigating fraud, would bring in more revenue than the cost of the county's part of the position.
That's correct. That would be from the incentives, yes.
But that's not in stone.
It's not in stone. It's just based on her trends and the way that she's been investigating. And we feel like with 2 investigators, then we actually have the potential to bring in more revenue.
Okay. But it's a little bit speculative.
It is. Mm. It is.
So we're adding $27.50 to what we would have to pay. That's right?
Okay. Right. That's correct.
Okay. Mr. Hager, do you have anything you want to say about it?
I have heard numerous reports about the investigator that DSS has. She is an outstanding employee, does a fantastic job. I've been subject to some of her reports, and she's well-respected around the state. And I know DSS has several priorities. I think this position and their attorney's position were their 2 main ones. That's from great. A personnel perspective this year. So if the board's interested in funding this position, you know, the key to this budget this year was, from the county's perspective, was to try to set up a budget that was sustainable, that we could, if our economic growth stays the same, that we can put ourselves in a position without a tax increase, that we can continue to take care of our employees, add a few strategic employees where needed, and stay on top of our capital, and give some amount of operating increase to each department, because the cost of business just continues to go up. So this is a valuable position. I would not tell the board that it's not worth putting another fraud investigator on at DSS. Simply a matter of keeping the budget within that sustainable context would be my desire. So if DSS can do this, and if they can do it in a way that, my suggestion would be, if the board doesn't have to add new county dollars to their budget, that would be ideal. That's from our financial perspective, that's ideal. But the board may want to do that even if it does take new county dollars, because of the value that the investigator brings to the table. So.
Well, that was going to be my question. If we added the position, would there have to be a roughly $27,000 adjustment made somewhere else in the budget? We have to cut what somebody else is projected to get by that amount.
I would ask DSS if they think it's possible for them, within the dollar amount that's been allocated for them, at this point, similar to what we just talked about with the sheriff. You know, the sheriff has said he can take the new revenue and find the needed revenue in his budget. I would say if DSS could find that additional revenue to guarantee that this position will be paid for based on the county dollars that have been allocated in the proposed budget that you have in your hands now, absolutely, I would support that. And even if you can't, Adrian, if it is a viable position that the board should consider.
Okay, we can definitely look at that.
Okay. That sounds like a good discussion.
I'd like to get before the next meeting a total year-to-date in the fiscal year, how much we spent on travel that was not certification mandated. Or the certification wasn't given as the reason as to why we want to do it. A grand total.
Okay.
And if you could separate the two, I'd appreciate it. And I'd like to ask a quickie. You know, we had an issue years ago of the report cards.
Yes.
And I think there were, what, 8 categories or 10 categories,
yes,
that we were grading in. Do they still do that?
They still do report card for food and nutrition services and Medicaid.
Uh-huh.
And I'm happy to say we are passing every month with flying colors.
Well, what were the categories prior?
So prior was it was completing the applications within 45 days or 30 days, and those were some struggles for us. But I think particularly in our food and nutrition services, we have really good staff there. We have streamlined that process and have kind of gotten it down. I will be coming before you soon with an MOU from the state, and there are 13 categories that they are measuring us in for next fiscal year. So that will be coming.
I had a couple questions. Tim had asked at the last budget hearing about the library. I think she had asked for.
It's okay if Adrian
steps
sorry. Down.
Yeah.
Okay.
No, you can't answer. I didn't feel while I was thinking about it.
That's fine. Maybe we'll have somebody else to come up. Yeah.
If I could, too, Chair Gally, before we move on, just let for Mr. Carter's question, our total fund balance is 32.7%. Our available fund balance is 24.7%. So that 24.7 is including things we've restricted and committed that the board could change their minds and unallocate. So those are pretty healthy numbers. It's just in the unassigned, the money that we have that you can choose right now without stopping something else to do other projects with. It's where we're getting down around 8.5% at the end of 18-19.
So that's the one the state's looking at too, right?
They'll be looking at all of this, but in particular this available, because they know that the board could, you know, like some of the things that we've committed to, you could change your minds and reallocate it. So.
It's my understanding that you said the top was, what, 32 million, whatever?
32.7%.
Is that not the umbrella or the whatever the state's looking at where they put the 8% tied to?
We will get full clarification on that.
I thought we had it.
There is a piece where they look at what is being restricted for the prior or the coming year commitments, and I believe that's around 11 million that we had for this year. But they do look at available fund balance, and with ours being 24.7%.
Okay. Well, what question is the 8% that everybody goes haywire over, and it's not mandated that the state's ever going to do anything if it gets below 8, and I'm not advocating that we go below 8. But my point is what door or window or bucket are they looking at as far as the total that 8% is put to? And it's my understanding it's that 32 million level. So we're not in too bad a shape.
Do you have a concern about the library?
Yes. It was brought up at our last meeting that there needs to be somebody at North Park. Can you address that?
I've had a number of comments made about that too.
Hi.
Hey.
So we had put in a request for an additional part-time staff member at the North Park Library. At the end of last fiscal year, the City of Burlington put in a new entrance for the North Park Library. So we weren't hidden inside that community center anymore. Previously, you had to go into the building, down a hallway, that had library on the door, but the door was always open, so you couldn't actually see the little library sign. And then down the hallway, and then in another door to get into the library. With the new entrance, it's right there immediately when you go into the first door to the community center. It's right there, big glass door where you can see into the library. Since then, they have, at the end of this fiscal year, they will have quadrupled their usage of that library. Wow. Because of the visibility. And a lot of that is the people just coming in, they're using the resources now, they're using the computers. When South Annex had to close due to the weather and the building damage, those two computers that were at South Annex got moved to the North Park Library because their computer usage and their classes that they're able to do has increased. Through a partnership with ACC, they offer free GED classes there now, and so the usage has gone up. And that library has been staffed by one full-time staff member for its entire life, which is about 40 years now, I think. We've come to a point where that staff member is doing everything, doing programming, doing hours, trying to help people on the computers. And we have to close from 3 to 4 o'clock in the afternoon because she does need to take a lunch break. And so our request for a part-time staff person is to help so that we don't have to close from 3 to 4 o'clock, that she's not working 4 nights a week herself anymore, and we can possibly extend the hours of North Park to Fridays and possibly a Saturday or two every month, because right now we're open from 12 to 8, Monday through Thursday.
And how much are you looking at budgeting for that position?
A part-time position would, I don't have the exact dollar figure in front of me, but it's no more than about $18,400 is the max for that.
Is it possible, okay, so North Park has quadrupled in usage. Do you have other libraries that have seen decreased usage? And is it possible to shift a position from another library where maybe the traffic isn't as much as it was 5-10 years ago?
Let's say we've looked at that possibility as well. Some usage has decreased at various libraries, but not enough to move a staff person away and lose all the hours of the staff person at any of the branches. I've also considered trying to share a position, so they did some hours at one library and some hours at North Park, and I haven't been able to figure out a way to make that work either, because the shared positions are a little more complicated and actually very hard, much harder to staff for a part-time person, where you're not giving them benefits and you're also sending them multiple times a week to multiple branches. And we've tried to figure out if that would work as well, and haven't been able to come up with a good solution.
Well, I would say I support it, number one, as I mentioned it last time. But that's a very economically depressed area, socioeconomically. And a library can't do anything but be a cog to change that to a degree. You should see the library they built on Summit Avenue in Greensboro. Not Summit. Was it Summit?
I think it is Summit.
Yeah, I mean, and it was a hole in the wall, and you should see what they put over there. And buddy, that area, I don't know that you go in there, is the clientele is just, it's really stunning compared to what clientele was in the original. And that was over on Summit, I believe Summit Avenue. How about Channel 2 and out that way? And could the school system maybe give us a comment on the number of students that possibly live in that vicinity of that library?
I think we could say the two, so East Lawn and Andrews Elementary, that are the closest two elementaries, are full. They're at capacity, and so.
No, I'm not talking about students. I'm talking about number of students, potential users of that library that would live in that vicinity.
Couldn't speak to that, but we could certainly find out.
I wouldn't mind knowing. Yeah.
So we're talking about adding a half position?
Part-time position.
Part-time.
I'm in favor of that too.
What would be the cost of that?
It's $18,000 roughly.
Yeah, roughly $18,000. Yes.
That's cheap. That's a good deal.
And if we were going to add that, Mr. Haygood, would we have to ask the same thing as I did for DSS? If we're going to add a position, are we going to have to cut from somewhere else?
Yes.
Well, there's places to do it.
Yeah.
Certainly.
I think that's a valuable asset to the community because, number one, they can use internet. And a lot of these children don't have access to internet once they go home.
Exactly.
Or on Saturday if they're working.
They have no transportation. They can't get to May Memorial and so forth and so on.
So you're saying that the library doesn't have $18,000, so we're asking VSS to go back and look at their budget and see if they can shift. You're saying that, in your opinion, at this point, you don't have the ability to shift those resources from a different place that you want, that it has to come out of another county department. Somebody else is going to have to give something up.
I'm 100% willing to look at it and double check and see if there's anything else within our own budget that could help fund the salary, yes.
That's my concern is got to do with not the value of the position at all. I completely, you know, agree with the things that other people have said. It's just that I think that where we can keep government from growing, we need to try to do that and conserve our resources. And I think that if somebody wants to add something, including myself, if you want to add something to the budget, then you should be prepared to say where it's going to come from.
That's one of the things I'm concerned about our county. We keep adding more employees every year. There seems to be anywhere up to 10. I think it's, but I approved this part-time. I think I've been asked that.
Okay. Does anybody else have any questions or comments for the library?
Well, if we can't find, forgive me, in $140-some million budget, right? Is that not right?
Yes, 171.
I'm talking general fund.
171.
Okay. Well, if we can't find whatever,
$18,000,
we need to get some new people to take a look at.
Sure.
171 is a big jump. That's because of the bonds.
Yeah.
Big jump.
Okay. Well, pre-bond.
Yeah.
141.
County government only 96.6.
Okay, well, I think I'm splitting hair on a figure here. Yeah. I got my head, I just can't put it out there. But you know, I was going to save this for budget night. I know how I'm going to vote. But doggone it, government, there's not a dollar they won't take if they can get it. And private business doesn't do it this way. And I don't know where it stops. I mean, we sit back and we say, yeah, we want to be progressive. Yeah, we want to do this. We want to improve. Yes, yes, yes. But once we blow it out of the water nationally, and it's almost there now, nobody's going to have anything. And you're going to really take a step backwards. But we just got to be tighter.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. Let me ask you another question about the budget. Mandatory retirement increases, to explain that to me.
The state of North Carolina has required, I think the new treasurer is interested in making sure that the state employee retirement fund, which is the same fund that we contribute to for county yeah. government employees, is more solvent. So they're requiring that the county, cities put more money in to the fund. So we put, I'm not sure what we have been putting, what percentage.
It says 1.2% for the law enforcement
mm-hmm.
and employees 1.26 increase. That's on page 148 also.
All righty. I know the reason is because that is a state requirement, yes. So
it's mandated by the state.
Yes, sir. So
what is the total that they're mandating that it has to be? And it says on this is 9.7 for law enforcement and 9.01 for county employees.
Yes, sir. So the total amount the increase for local government retirement fund that the county is required to pay by the state is an additional $489,284 for 1920. And that has increased the percentage that the county has to pay for law enforcement by the 1.2%. So we now pay 9.7% into the state retirement system for law enforcement officers.
9.7 will be what we will be paying for fiscal year 1920. Currently, we pay 8.5%
okay.
for their yeah. retirement benefits. Mm-hmm. And for any other employees who are not sworn law officers, it will increase to 9.01 following the same increases as required by the state treasurer's office.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Last year we had the 800,000. Was that not the 800,000 issue that we took out of the savings from a performance-based budget? Or was that 2 years ago?
I know we took money out for the past 2 years to help fund the acquisition of the sheriff's vehicles.
I understand that. I'm talking about there was $800,000 that we did something in personnel with.
That was, if I'm not mistaken, that would have been for the performance bonuses that we paid not this fiscal year, but previous fiscal year.
The last bonuses that we paid from performance management were 2 years ago. So we haven't had the funding available, I think, for the past two fiscal years.
But I can verify that dollar amount.
Yeah. Well, we didn't have to.
That's how much it was.
That was just a voluntary thing you did, I think, on that. It wasn't mandated.
That's right.
And there was a previous year where we did take $500,000 out of our fund balance that came out of the performance management fund to fund the school system.
Yeah, I remember that.
Okay, there was a concern raised about farmland preservation budgeting at the public hearing. I think Mr. Bell had raised the point, there's a very good point, that in our auditing of the present use value program, whereby people who have met the requirements for being, for lack of a better word, certified as a farm, either through forestry or horticulture, those people get a break on their property taxes, and there were people who had been receiving that tax break who weren't actually operating a bona fide farm or didn't meet the requirements of the statute. And so our tax department has been auditing that program, and has quite a large number of properties have been found to be not in compliance with the requirements of the statute and have been removed from the program and started paying the full rate on their property taxes. And Mr. Bell was making the point that some of that money should be, or more of that money should be routed toward the farmland preservation program. Currently, the farmland preservation gets $100,000, and that money is used to match funds that come from the state, generally matching funds coming from the state for farmland preservation, where the property owner sells their development rights and is not able to sell the property for development. It has to be operated as a farm in perpetuity. So Mr. Vines, did I say all that right? Did I get that right? All right. I didn't have any notes. That was all off my head. So does anybody have any concerns that they want to raise about that? About how much is allocated to farmland preservation?
I think we need to increase that 100,000 to double it, 200,000.
And where will these funds come from?
Well, let the manager decide.
Okay. We're going to throw it on the manager.
He's in control of the money.
We know where it's coming from, but the problem is
coming from the taxpayers.
Yeah.
All the money comes from the taxpayers.
That's exactly
right. And we need to make sure everybody understands that.
I'd like Brad Moore. He is our wonderful soil and water
and doing a good
supervisor.
Job.
Supervisor, what do you call it? Are you a supervisor?
Director.
So one of the concerns or questions that I had in serving on the Voluntary Agriculture District Board is if we're going to increase the amount of money that's available for farmland preservation, and this the VAD board is the board which evaluates the applications for the farmland preservation program and then sends them off to the state to be evaluated to see if we can get the matching funds. Is that right?
Yes, ma'am.
So how many properties, like, tell us about the number of properties that y'all have been looking at and their size, and what have y'all been doing with the money in the past year or two?
In the past year or two, so if you remember several years ago or a few years ago, the funding set aside for the board, from this board, stopped for various reasons. There was a lull in things moving forward with the state. We basically sent applications to the state that did not get selected, so there were a few years, and the funding accumulated, to my knowledge, around close to $250,000. At that time, the funding stopped. There was other needs in other places within the county, so forth. So since that time, we have been successful in sending applications. We generally always send applications. Whether or not they get funded is out of our control. But we did, since that time, we did get an application in that was selected by the state and the county's portion of that 50%. On that particular case was around a 75-acre farm, and the county's portion was around $100,000. So right off the bat, $100,000 was used for that farm. We have been successful two more times since then sending applications. We're allowed to send two applications per year, and whether or not we send one application or two depends on our part of the funding, whether we have enough for two or one. So we were able to successfully send off two applications. One of those, the county's portion, was right around $75,000 for around a 75-acre farm. The other successful application was around 88 acres and right around $82,000-$83,000. So you can see that each application that is successful requires, on average, if you just average them up, our last four applications, the average acreage is 76 acres for an average price of what the county's portion is, around $75,000. The average of the 75 acres and the $75,000 basically become because we are sending applications of acreage that match our money. It's kind of like buying tires. You got your money set aside, and you decide which type of tire you're going to buy. If we were to do larger farms, basically it would just more funding. I'd like to also mention that a few of these, the landowner, the farmers, have donated 25% of what the total value is. They have donated that, which means they're not being compensated for that part. And if, for those of you who may not be familiar, simply the state provides 50% of the total value. They provide 50 on average, the county provides 25%, and the landowner provides a 25% donation. We are interested in people who are interested in donating a portion for a couple different reasons. Number one is their main interest, farmland preservation. So if so, they're of course can donate what they wish. The other is this being good stewards of the money that's been provided and providing the most bang for the buck, so to speak. Because of our somewhat limited funding, for an example, these people that I've mentioned who have successful applications, they have been selected by the state. We have a 5-year wait period so before they can reapply, even within our own county VAD, or farmland preservation, because more times than not, and we're only protecting a very small part of the entire farm. So I think one that we did a few years ago, we protected around 75 acres, but there's about 300 acres in the farm. We didn't have the money to put up for the 300 acres, but we did have enough for the 75. This last year, I'm sorry for the long answer.
Oh.
For an example, we did have five applicants, ranging from their farms ranging from a couple of them around 100 acres. The high was 233 acres, from a low to around 50 acres. And basically, the funding we have on hand does determine the acres that we can apply to the state simply because of the match.
Okay.
So how many applications do you have in a pipeline right now?
Well, we currently do it year to year. We do it every September. The applications have to be in Raleigh every December, and we have to wait until the budget is finalized, usually the following July or September. So, for example, we've sent in an application back in December for a 64.6 acre farm, and we're still waiting to hear back. I would dare say the five people we have, as well as others, would be interested. Alluding to what Chairman Gary Lee is talking about, 2007 was the very first year that this program was in place here in the county. We had a high of 27 applicants. To last year, the past several years, we fluctuated around 5 to 7 to 9, somewhere in there. The interest is still there, but I believe the perception that is out there is, number one, it's a very long process and people feel that there's not much money and or chance for them to get in. Like many things in life, the people that are successful are the people who continue to work forward the work and apply.
What do you have as a balance in that fund right now?
We currently, today, to the figures that I have, is just shy of $68,000. So with right now, with a average project, currently where we're at, costing around $75,000, that's just shy of possibly one project.
And has the state set their budget on what in their general fund to what they're going to fund on this?
I mean, the past several years, I haven't got that final figure. It's usually around a little over $2 million for the entire state.
$2 million for the whole?
For the entire state.
And that's a biennial, right? That's the biennial budget, so it's like $1 million per year.
And it varies. There are some special funds dedicated to the military areas, which we're not in those zones. We have been successful, in my opinion, for different reasons, but one is that, to my understanding, Alamance County is one of the very few 4 or 5 counties in the state who does provide funding. I'll give you an example. Our neighbors, perhaps in Caswell, if a landowner wanted to do this, they would simply be donating the other 50%. They would not receive any funding at all.
Does anybody have any more questions for him? Thank you. Does anybody have any comments about farmland preservation? I don't want to cut off the bait or keep anybody from saying anything. I have some thoughts myself about farmland preservation. You know, this is something that is very, very near and dear to my heart in preserving the character of our county and our authenticity and our agriculture, heritage and local food and supporting our economy. Agriculture is the number one industry in North Carolina. There's a list as long as the arm of the reasons to support agriculture and farmland preservation. One of my questions is whether or not adding to this particular budget is the best way to do it. I think that we need to look at farmland preservation as being more in Alamance County than purchasing the development rights from property owners. For example, we're looking at a process for land use, for developing a small area plan, possibly for Snow Camp or other areas of the county. Which would be an expensive and time-consuming process where we make decisions about where we're going to locate heavy industrial businesses and how we're going. Farmland preservation is about more than buying development rights. It's also about looking at the uses of land throughout the whole county and finding ways to direct land use to where it would be best planned. So I would wonder if we were going to spend another $100,000 on farmland preservation, we could spend half or less than that and add a position to the planning department so that they have people and resources there to proceed forward with our land use activity. I'm not making any motion. I'm not proposing that we add a position. I'm offering that as an example that we need to look sort of at a larger range of alternatives of action rather than just staying committed to one narrow lane. Another thing that, and this is not really so much to do with the budget, but another example of how to look at farmland preservation is being more than just about one thing. When the county manager presented his facilities plan, and it included incorporating incorporating an expansion of the courthouse and keeping the county government and the county court services located in downtown Graham, some people have suggested, well, maybe we should just go outside of the municipality and do like they've done in other counties and do a separate court campus and start from scratch. Well, I would argue that that would be fly in the face of farmland preservation, because when you build large buildings, government buildings, that attracts development, it attracts other uses, it encourages people to be on the road, and it's not really done with an eye toward supporting agriculture and supporting farmers. It has a long-term effect of hurting agriculture because you're spreading the use of the land. So those, in my opinion, are just ways that we need to broaden our view of farmland preservation and be more creative. And, you know, every decision that we make, I think we should be looking at it in a way that, does it support agriculture? Does it have an effect of harming agriculture and farmland preservation? So that's all I have to say about that.
As we move into the planning process, land allocation process, whatever, doesn't what's already in agriculture have to stay in agriculture as you go through that process?
Agriculture, it doesn't. Agriculture is protected by the process.
That's what I mean, right. Exactly.
Yes. The farmer still has the choice about what they want to do with their land, but you can't take them out of an agriculture use and make them do something.
So they would have to petition, once it had been, the planning process had set that as agriculture, then they would have to request a variation, a variance, which would have to be approved by whatever approval authority we set up, right?
I defer to Mr.
Albright. If we go to the zoning.
Well, if you were zoned agricultural, if
right.
we had zoning, and a developer comes in and buys the farm, then they would ask that it be rezoned.
But he'd have to apply
yes.
for a variance.
Well, for a
yeah,
rezoning.
But you got,
a rezoning, yeah.
You're trying to put the chicken before the egg in what you're saying.
Right.
There are a lot of protections for agriculture in the framework of land use in the state law. Does anybody have anything else? Thank you.
Thank you.
Does anybody have any other concerns about the budget that they want to raise?
Got one more question here. Mr. Vines had asked me yesterday about this, and we couldn't remember what page he was looking at when he did, but he's found it. Mm-hmm. On page 38, there's a $12 million transfer of other funds, 474%. Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Say page 38.
Yes, please.
Okay. Let me get to that correct page, Commissioner Carter. But I believe what you're looking at is for the transfer to other funds.
Right.
What that is doing, and yes, that figure is correct, with us having the upfront property tax for our bonds, we would be putting those funds in reserve. They would be collected in the general fund. And then at the end of the year would be transferred over to the capital reserve funds.
Okay.
So yes, that figure is correct.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything else?
Yeah, I got one more. I don't know why I keep thinking of something I want to ask before we go, because we're coming down to one more meeting. We raise the taxes, which we got to, for the bonds. How much of the increase or the monies that come in as a result of that will actually be paid out in that fiscal year? In other words, what would be the first fiscal year that we would actually pay a bond payment?
So,
and is it partial at that?
Yes, so what we've been proposing to the board is a one-time property tax increase for the entire project timeline. I think the, let me get my stuff in front of me. So we start issuing
school system bonds by March of 2021. And we are, well, I'm sorry, not start. They are, I think they're all issued by then. The bond construction ends March of 2023 for ABSS. For the school system, the bond construction ends August of 2023. So the money that is created by the property tax increase for the 7.04 cents, we start putting it in capital reserve to start making those payments as they come due. So they won't all be due in fiscal year 1920. There'll only be a small portion of them due, I think, in 1920.
We have talked about proposing to do an early sale at the end of fiscal year 2020, around springtime. What that would do is it would help us with the upfront cost of acquiring the land and some of the upfront architectural design cost. Those bond payments are not usually due until 6 months later. So if we were to purchase the bonds in March, following 6 months, we would have our first interest payment, which would put us in fiscal year 2021. And at that point in time, we would use those upfront reserves that we had collected during fiscal year 1920 for that purpose.
So we'll be bankrolling this revenue as it comes in, either using it to pay upfront costs to the school system or the community college, or to start paying bond debt when it comes due. The idea being this 7.04 cent property tax increase is all that would be needed for the duration of all of the project.
More questions? All right. Thank you. Let's have a 10-minute recess.
Well, before we do, what's left on the agenda? I'm curious.
We got budget amendments, public speaker. We got closed session.
Yeah, that's good.
That might take a while. Thank you. If we could come back to order, please, and resume our meeting. The next thing on our agenda is a budget amendment from emergency management. Come steady, Hatfield.
Good morning, Commissioners.
Good morning. Good morning.
I'm here today to ask for your approval for a budget amendment of $1,000. This is for the 2019 Tier 2 grant monies. We receive these every year from the state of North Carolina to help us with our LEPCs. This goes to anybody that has an active LEPC in their county, and this money is to be used for training or planning, exercises, or anything of that nature. And it's 100%, and we don't have to make any match.
I'll make a motion.
Second.
We have a motion and a second to approve the budget amendment. Is there any discussion? Mm-hmm. If not, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Thank you.
Thank you. Next item on the agenda is our second public comment period. Mr. Bell, did you want to come on up?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, fellow commissioners. I want to challenge your thinking. We want to go a different direction. We're talking about farmland preservation. I want to give you some exact facts. Since 2007 and 2016, there's been 113 applications in the county for farmland preservation. We've accepted four. The submitted acreage for that period of time has been 14,371 acres. So much for that. We've submitted and we've approved four. What I want to share with you is how to pay for all of this. All of you know, in 2009, and my position with the county is the ENR chairman for the last 9 years. We've seen a problem.
Tell what ENR means.
Sir?
Tell us what ENR means.
Equalization and review.
That's right.
Problems, solving problems. We went out on a mission, and currently we have got in the cleanup that the chairman has spoke to of PUV farms that are in compliance and are not in compliance. We have taken out of that program 477 farms that was not in compliance. Now, what that does, we accumulate revenue, 3 years back taxes plus penalty order. Penalty for back tax for 3 years. The accumulation as of November the 17th of last year, the cleanup, the revenue for the county, that's that rolling you're talking about to the treasurer or to the county revenue, $1,313,543 is the profit for that was rolled back into the treasurer of this county.
We're bringing in more taxes because of that.
That's right. It cost to collect that $2,085 only cost us $772. What happened, and you was involved in this, we added two people to the present use value. My thinking and my proposal and suggestion to you is that we're faced with farmland preservation going forward. We got problems in the South for trying to protect land in that state. Let's change our thinking and agriculture right now is paying 59 cents for every dollar that we pay in agriculture to the county. We only using 59 cents of that. My proposal to you, and don't change, let's look at, let agriculture, the revenue from agriculture, pay going forward for farmland preservation.
Mr. Bell, I have to interrupt you because you're a minute over, and we had another speaker. We have had speakers in the past who went over, and it did not work out well.
I'm going to say one
thing. Any of us.
The occurring revenue for this county going forward is $997,672. That's every year. That's what it's made to the fund. So reconsider that and look for a way we can pay for it.
Thank you, Mr. Bell. It's important that we try to enforce the rules the same for everybody. So thank you for all that information. So Mr. Haga, do you have a county manager report today?
I do not.
Okay, we have commissioner comments. Before we go into closed session, I did have one thing to bring to the board's attention. Linda Jones with DSS, she brought this up at the DSS board meeting. She had an email from somebody who had come to evaluate and study DSS as part of a process that the organization was going through. And she got an email back from him, which I thought was really remarkable. She read it at the DSS board meeting, and I asked her to send it to me so I could share it with you all. Because we so often get complaints and cranky remarks about our buildings and their maintenance or other features of our facilities. And so this gentleman emailed her, Linda Jones, and said, I personally thank you for the opportunity to visit the Alamance County DSS office. Of all the similar organizations and offices like yours, I have visited over the past 13 years, and there have been many. This was the nicest and most welcoming DSS office I have ever visited. Your trauma-informed approach to layout and design of the space makes the office feel less like an institutional facility and more like a professional, respectful atmosphere. So when I heard that, I thought, well, I have got to make sure my other commissioners hear that good word about our facilities.
That's good to
know. So, does anybody else have any comments?
I do.
Yes, sir.
I hope by what Mr. Bell said to our county managers and management team that we in the future, we need to really, in my opinion, concentrate on helping those people stay farmers and keep the land and farming and to farming. We got to eat in the future. I'm not going to be around much longer, maybe 10, maybe 30, 50 years, but I want the people who are going to be to eat well.
Yes, sir.
I for one would love to hear the rest of what Mr. Bell had to say, maybe in a different opportunity.
Sure. Well, I'm sure he has your phone number too.
Yeah.
And ours. I know he has mine. Glad for it. All right. Is anybody else? All right. If not, I move that we now go into closed session pursuant to North Carolina General Statute Section 143-318.11A3 in order to preserve the attorney-client privilege between the county attorney and the board and consult with the county attorney regarding the claims made in the cases entitled Sutz v. Alamance County, River Reels versus Sheriff of Alamance County, Casual Escapes versus Sheriff of Alamance County, Hines and Thompson's versus Sheriff of Alamance County, Tickles versus Sheriff of Alamance County, Alamance County versus Care Ends, claims before the North Carolina Code Officials Qualification Board, claims in the Billy Carson Pike shooting. So if I could have a second to that
second.
Motion. So we have a motion and a second. If there's no discussion, all in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you.
So moved.
Second.
So we have a motion and a second to go back into open session. All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Proposed statement to public after closed session. The board received legal advice from county attorney concerning these cases and claims. All right. Is there any more business before the board? If not, then we'll be adjourned.
3 o'clock.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Alamance County Board of Commissioners occur on the first and third Monday of every month in the Commissioners' Chambers at the County Office Building at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month occurs at 9 a.m. and the second meeting occurs at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the county website at www.alamance-nc.com. The video of this meeting is broadcast on LocalGov TV. Please go to www.localgovtvnc.com for more information about this schedule and to see more videos produced by your local governments. You can also access this meeting through our website at www.alamance-nc.com or at our YouTube channel. Technical questions regarding this meeting's broadcast or production may be sent to our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. This address is for technical questions only. Comments and questions about the content of the meeting may be made to the commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information at the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. There, you can click on the link that says County Commissioners to learn more about our commissioners, read minutes and agendas of commissioner meetings, and find other information about the county commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Thanks for tuning in. If you're watching on YouTube, be sure to hit the subscribe button to stay up to date on all our latest video content. If you're watching on LocalGov TV, be sure to visit their website to see all of the content made for you by your local governments.